Take a look at the vocabulary. Feel free to pause the video at any point if I go too fast. Alright, so we'll open up with a case that was using odontology or dentistry, forensic dentistry evidence very centrally, and that is the Ted Bundy case. Pretty well known, 1974. Ted Bundy targeted college women, and they began going missing about one per month. And this eventually ended as police did track him down. But Ted Bundy escaped to Florida, murdered two women, and left bite marks on one of the victims. It was largely that bite mark which caused Ted Bundy's conviction and eventually his execution for his crimes. So let's talk about what odontology is and what it entails. Study the anatomy and growth of teeth, diseases associated with the teeth and gums. So an odontologist and a dentist are really the same thing. Now, a forensic odontologist uses that knowledge to help ID victims, criminal investigations, and verify any signs of abuse. So, in order to understand this, we need to understand a little bit more about the structure and function of teeth. The mouth is the starting place of digestion. There are enzymes, and then teeth are there to mechanically grind the food. And there are three regions of the teeth. The top part that protrudes out that you see is the crown. The neck is going to be in the middle portion here where it connects with the gum, and then the root is below the gum. And then there are three layers. So the outer layer is the enamel. By the way, it's true you shouldn't sit there and suck on a lemon because that does deteriorate the enamel of your teeth, which helps to protect what's underneath, the dentin. And then the pulp cavity is where the capillaries supply blood flow to that living body. Okay, and here's a look at those three layers again, dentin, pulp, and enamel. So the cementum is a bone-like substance right in here that covers the dentin, this pink layer, within the root. And then the periodontal ligament is what you see right here, which anchors the tooth to the bone of the jaw and keeps alignment, acts as a shock absorber. These are three different views of x-rays. So the panoramic shows the full set of teeth from the front, the bite wing x-ray on the side, and then the periapical x-ray here. A little bit of history. Your baby teeth are also called your deciduous teeth, and there are a total of 20 of them, and then 32 adult or permanent teeth, and that includes your wisdom teeth. So a lot of people actually are walking around with 28. But you can see that these are divided into incisors, which are the frontmost teeth, then canines, which are generally the pointy teeth, premolars, and then molars in the back. So a forensic odontologist may compare dental records with victim remains. This could be a positive identification, and this is a source of individual evidence. Also, dental alterations are very helpful. Fillings, caps, bridge work, dentures, those have serial numbers on them, which is great in terms of individual evidence. And then you can look at specific things about the teeth, the size, shape, gaps, missing, extra teeth, stains, anything like that. And then dentition is the pattern made by a particular set of teeth. This is pretty neat. This is a chart that shows age estimation based on teeth. And I automatically went to the 2 years because at the time of this recording, my daughter is just about to experience her second birthday. And I think at my last count, which is very difficult because she resists this, but at my last count, she has 18 teeth. So she's got almost all of them of her deciduous teeth. But one thing that's amazing to me is, look at this. This is 5 months in utero. So about 4 months before birth, look at the formation of the teeth that are still embedded in the gums. And of course, this line here is the gum line. And then at birth, there are even these molars that have begun to form at the time of birth that have just not protruded yet. So in looking at ancestry. It is impossible to say for sure that because of these physical remains, this person was of this particular ethnicity or ancestry, although there are more common characteristics of certain people groups. So for one thing, the shape of the decedent's incisors can be helpful. If it's a straight incisor, that's more typical of European and African individuals, whereas the shovel-shaped incisor, shaped a little bit more like this when you look down on it, is more common in the Mongoloid, specifically Australian Aborigines and South Pacific Islanders, with the rocker jaw as well. So a couple of characteristics in that way. Now, when we talk about estimating male versus female, teeth are tough. You know, the skull is really nice. This is a male you see on the left, female on the right. We've got the square-shaped skull, the square-shaped orbits of the male, more broad jawline. For the female, it may be that the males tend to have larger teeth, and females tend to have pointier canines, but a little bit tough to make those calls for sure. So in making a positive identification, there are two types of identification. There's presumptive, which is just as its name suggests, and this can be with whatever kinds of personal effects or identification on the body, in the pockets, whatever, family ID, location. But positive ID can be done with fingerprints, DNA, medical, and dental records. So it's really up there as being a big type of evidence. So forensic odontologists would compare ante or before death records as well with postmortem records. And then, as we mentioned before, any kind of dental work that was done is really helpful. Fillings, bridge work, dental implants, which have the serial numbers. So the next type of dental evidence that can be evaluated is bite mark. And we talked a little bit about this in a prior episode, but depending on the substrate, you can tell a lot about a person's dentition using a bite mark. This could be in something like a piece of cheese, like you see up here, or unfortunately in another human being. And so if the bite mark occurs before death of the victim, then obviously the area will bruise and swell as a response to that trauma. Of course, if the bite mark occurs post-mortem, then you don't have that kind of response. And then this is a typical human bite mark impression with kind of the horseshoe pattern, as needs to be differentiated with an animal pattern, which usually has more of a conical, kind of triangular shape to it. So, and here are a couple of other human bite marks. Different lighting can be used to try to evaluate contrasts. And so we talked about the inflammation happening, antemortem. One thing that can be done is to actually make a cast of the bite mark impression. And this is a cast here. So what that consists of is taking the skin or the food item and actually pouring in a dental stone, which will solidify and be able to be a way to preserve that bite mark. And then another way to evaluate bite mark analysis is to do a transparent overlay, which we'll do in lab, and you can actually place the dentition over the bite mark picture and compare. So animal bite marks, we mentioned, have a very different dentition than human bite marks. They have a different dental formula, which is something else that we'll evaluate in lab, which is the comparison of the numbers of different categories of teeth. And then swabbing can be done as well to possibly get DNA. So let's say that this diagram represents a bite mark in a human, and the bite mark is in, let's say it's in the back. And so I have a question for you. Would you swab at place number 1, 3, 4, and or 2? What do you say? If you said 1 would be a good place to swab for DNA, then you'd be right, because that's where the lips would be, which may have some deposited cheek cells from the saliva. And 3 would be a terrible place to swab, because attorneys may say, oh, you altered the tooth mark impression. You swabbed right there. So you wouldn't want to swab directly on that bite mark. 4 would be a good place to swab, because that's where the tongue is. And even though it seems unrelated, 2 would be a good place to swab, because that's your control. That way, if you get the victim's DNA in there, then you have that for comparison. All right. So I hope you learned a lot about forensic dentistry, and we'll say thanks for joining in. Take a look at the summary.